In Singapore.
And I'm Kasia Madeira in London. Our headlines this hour.
Thailand's political crisis remains in deadlock as the Prime Minister insists she won't resign as the protests continue. Britain's Prime Minister orders an urgent inquiry into the storming of Amritsar's Golden Temple, but was the UK involved in the deadly attack?
Feeling the heat, Australian Open organisers are criticised for forcing tennis players to compete in temperatures above 40 degrees Celsius. And police search the home of pop star Justin Bieber after he allegedly threw eggs at his neighbour's home in Los Angeles.
It's 9 a.m. here in Singapore.
And it's 1 a.m. here in London, broadcasting to viewers around the world. Welcome to Newsday.
Welcome to the programme. We begin with the latest from Thailand, and the Prime Minister, Yingluck Shinawatra, has insisted she will not resign despite facing intense pressure from opposition protesters. Let's just take you to the scene live on the streets of Bangkok, where protesters have blockaded the streets for a third day in a row. Seven major road junctions have been blocked and some government buildings have been surrounded. The anti-government demonstrators say that they will stay on the streets until they achieve their objective, the forced resignation of the Prime Minister, who they, of course, accuse of being corrupt. Well, the government does still enjoy majority support in the country, and there is now growing concern that the crisis could become unpredictable and violent. The BBC's John Sudworth has been gauging the mood on the streets.
On a moped, the transport choice of many in this city, of course, it is still possible to get around. The protesters are blocking some main road junctions in Bangkok city centre, but it's still moving. The trains are still running and the commuters are coming in to work. So this is hardly a city completely shut down. But on the other hand, the protesters are clearly having some effect. This flyover, for example, completely closed, and they're promising to keep this up, to stay on the streets day after day until the Prime Minister resigns.
And so, while many businesses are trying to stay open, there's no doubt that trade is suffering. And as the political crisis drags on and seems to worsen year by year, there's always the concern about the harm this is doing to the wider economy.
This lady's been telling me that she doesn't support either side and that protests are simply bad for business.
The leader of this protest movement, Suthep Thaugsaban, offers Thailand's business community little hope of a speedy conclusion. His supporters say they'll stay here for as long as it takes to force the Prime Minister from office.
We want to win, because if we would not win the Thailand in the future, we will have a problem.
And what is winning for you?
Winning? That is mean that this government has to get out.
Seems like they're going to stay here till she's going to leave or some other thing going to happen, some major thing.
And yet, if this man does succeed, the government supporters are sure to react. And there'll be some justification to their claim that these people have won through mass protest what they've been unable to achieve at the ballot box. John Sudworth, BBC News, Bangkok.
And do stay with us a little later in the programme. We'll be talking to Kirsty Kenny, the current US ambassador to Thailand. That coming up a little later on. Now, let's just catch up with some of the day's other news for you now. And President Hollande of France has admitted he's having difficulties in his private life following widespread reports of an affair with an actress. But at a news conference call to give details of his plans for France's economy, he refused to say whether his partner Valérie Trevelyan was still France's first lady. Security has been tight across Egypt for the first of 2 days of voting on a draft constitution. At least 9 people have been killed in clashes at polling stations. Well, opponents of the new constitution say it's not valid, as it was drafted by the military-backed government that took power after the former president Mohamed Morsi was overthrown in July of last year. Japan Airlines has been forced to ground one of its new Boeing 787 planes after another problem with its high-tech battery system. The incident happened during maintenance at Tokyo's Narita Airport. Engineers noticed smoke venting from the plane's equipment bay. Last year, all 787s were grounded worldwide for 3 months. The British government has ordered an urgent investigation into whether the United Kingdom was involved in a deadly raid on a Sikh temple in the Indian city of Amritsar in 1984. Well, recently unclassified documents suggest that an SAS officer advised Indian authorities prior to the storming of the temple, in which hundreds of people died. Carol Walker reports.
The storming of the Golden Temple in Amritsar angered Sikhs around the world, who blamed Indian troops for violating their holiest shrine. Now, documents released under the 30-year rule appear to show the British were involved. One Foreign Office letter says, with the Prime Minister's agreement, an SAD officer has visited India and drawn up a plan which has been approved by Mrs. Gandhi. There seems to be a typing error and it should read SAS. The letter warns this could increase violence in India and warns it might also therefore increase tension in the Indian community here, particularly if knowledge of the SAS involvement were to become public. Some MPs believe all the evidence of British involvement must now be released.
I think there are further documentations. I think what we want is a full, candid disclosure of all documentation and a proper examination so that we can get to the bottom of exactly what happened here.
Even after 30 years, Sikhs here in Britain want to know the truth about what happened at Amritsar. We're told neither David Cameron nor the Foreign Secretary William Hague were aware of the documents suggesting Britain's involvement until they were published, but that they do understand the very legitimate concerns that will be raised by the revelations.
At the largest Sikh temple outside India, in Southall, West London, a community leader welcomed the Prime Minister's decision to ask the Cabinet Secretary to investigate.
This is a holy place for the Sikhs. All the holy place for any religion, it's matter. It's heartbreaking things. So these things not go out from your mind. It's not a small things. That's why if the truth is come out, at least people know.
Last year, David Cameron became the first serving British Prime Minister to visit the Golden Temple at Amritsar. He's keen to focus on the historic and cultural ties with Sikhs, but now he's under pressure to uncover more about Britain's role in an event which is seared into their history. Carol Walker, BBC News.
Over to London now, and Cash, you've got details of how Israel is trying to defuse a row with its main ally, America. What's happening?
Well, Israel is certainly trying to, Babita. It was after the Israeli defense minister was quoted as describing the US Secretary of State John Kerry as obsessive in his search for peace in the Middle East. A late-night statement issued by the Israeli defense ministry offered an apology for any offense caused by Moshe Ya'alon's comments. Well, our correspondent in Washington, Barbara Plett-Usher, is monitoring all of this. And Barbara, this is uncharacteristically vitriolic comments between these two allies. Just tell us, what was said by who?
Well, Moshe Ya'alon has been quite openly skeptical of John Kerry's peace efforts, but apparently in private conversations he's been scathingly dismissive of them. He was particularly critical in this newspaper article of Mr. Kerry's suggested security arrangements for the Jordan Valley, which is on the eastern border of the West Bank. He said that those security proposals were not worth the paper they were written on. He said that Mr. Kerry was operating from an incomprehensible obsession and a sense of messianism. And he said the only thing that can save us is if Kerry wins the Nobel Prize and leaves us alone. And not surprisingly, there was an outrage from Washington, especially as Mr. Kerry has thrown heart and soul into this peace effort. He's been to Israel 10 times in less than a year and had just been there and was planning to go back again soon. The State Department said that if accurate, these comments were offensive and inappropriate.
Now, the relationship between Israel and the United States is somewhat strained, not least over the deal over Iran's nuclear program. Do you think this is all coming into one now?
Well, I mean, it's not unusual for there to be differences between Israel and the United States. Like you said, the Israelis are not happy with this interim agreement that the Americans have made with Iran. They want much harsher stance towards Iran. There's also been tensions about Israel's continued building of Jewish settlements in the occupied Palestinian territories at a time when they're supposed to be talking about ways to make that territory into a Palestinian state. So those things simmer along. It is unusual, though, for such harsh and insulting language to be had, and that explains why the Israelis have been moving so quickly to try to defuse these tensions. They may have differences with the United States, but they're very aware that they have a very special relationship with Washington and that America is their most important ally, and they want to protect that.
Okay, Barbara, we'll leave it there. But for now, Barbara Plett-Usher from Washington, thank you very much, as always. Now let's catch up with some of the day's other news, and let's start in China, because the country's Xinhua news agency has reported that a doctor in northern China will appeal against her suspended death sentence for stealing newborn babies and selling them to child traffickers. The obstetrician convinced the parents that their babies had serious health problems and should be cared for by the state. 32 people have been killed and nearly 200,000 others evacuated in the Philippines as floods and landslides hit a southern region of Mindanao. The area, which is still recovering from Typhoon Bopha in 2012, was hit by torrential rain on the eastern section of the island at the weekend. 13 people are said to be still unaccounted for. The United Nations human rights chief has criticized what she called a draconian new law in Nigeria that criminalizes same-sex marriage, gay clubs and organizations. Navi Pillay said that rarely had she seen a piece of legislation that in so few paragraphs directly violated so many basic universal human rights. Now, the Australian Open tennis has been a sizzling competition so far, but not necessarily in the way that people might have wanted. Intense temperatures in Melbourne, peaking at over 42 degrees Celsius even, left players clutching at ice packs between points. Well, ABC reporter Tony Nichols, who's at the tournament there, told me just how hot it's been getting.
37 degrees right now. We're here at the Botanical Gardens in the city, just south of the river. We're heading for a top of 41 degrees yesterday. That follows 43 degrees that we got yesterday. And it got down as low as 28 degrees overnight. So scorching temperatures right now. Tomorrow, we're up to 41 degrees, and that will be replicated again on Friday.
And Tony, the organisers of the Australian Open very much under criticism for continuing to allow players to play under such intense conditions. How do they decide whether it's safe?
Some criticism, really, a mixed court of opinions, really. Some players out on court are talking about dancing on fire, they feel, when they're playing on centre court. A Canadian player has said that the conditions are inhumane. He, in fact, passed out during his three-set match and said that he saw the cartoon character Snoopy before passing out. He passed out for about a minute, got up and played out the three sets and lost. Azarenka said it's like, as I mentioned, dancing on fire. Wozniak said that when she put her water bottle down on court yesterday, she in fact believed it melted. So that they are really are harsh conditions. But players like top seeds such as Roger Federer say that this is what players train for, it's what they play for, and that this kind of heat is the sort of heat that players can play through and endure. The tournament referee has the discretion as to whether or not play is suspended or halted, or the roofs on the major stadiums are closed, or if ice vests and the like are deployed onto the court. The tournament referee, the chief medical officer and the tournament director and the weather bureau that are all on court are monitoring conditions minute by minute. They believe that players can play in dry heat, but it's when that heat is accompanied by high humidity that it gets quite dangerous for players. So it's the humidity that the tournament referee is watching, and if this humidity continues to rise, we could see more of the extreme heat policy implemented throughout this week of the two-week tournament.
I'll read off this. You're watching Newsday on the BBC, live from Singapore and London, still to come on the programme. Easing tensions over the arrest of an Indian diplomat in New York, the US returns one of the world's most wanted stolen artworks to India.
First, let's bring you up to date with some news from across the UK. And a jury on the opening day of the trial of the Coronation Street actor William Roach have been told to disassociate the defendant from the character he plays in the soap. The 81-year-old is accused of raping a 15-year-old girl in 1967 and indecently assaulting four other girls between 1965 and 1971. He denies all the charges. The prosecution has started to outline its case in the trial of Dave Lee Travis, the former BBC presenter. He's accused of a series of sex offences, including an alleged assault while he was presenting an edition of Top of the Pops. The 68-year-old, whose real name is David Griffin, denies 13 counts of indecent assault and one of sexual assault. And for the first time in over 4 years, the Bank of England's inflation target has been met. The consumer price index fell from 2.1% to 2% in December.
This is Newsday on the BBC. I'm Babita Sharma in Singapore.
And I'm Kesha Madeira in London. Our headlines this hour. Thailand's Prime Minister insists she won't resign as she prepares to meet opposition leaders trying to close down parts of the capital for a third day.
Britain's Prime Minister orders an inquiry into whether the UK was involved in a deadly raid on Amritsar's Golden Temple nearly 30 years ago. Now, across the world, conflicts are being played out every day. As part of a BBC series, we've been speaking to the young members of armed forces around the world. In Pakistan, Mariam Muktia is training to become a fighter pilot in the Pakistan Air Force. She told us about becoming a female pilot in a male-dominated world.
I'm pilot officer Mariam Mukhtiar from Karachi, and I'm 21 years old. I'm undergoing training in Advanced Jet Training Squadron, PF Academy, Lhasa. I decided to join PF because I was very much motivated by the discipline and the uniform and their pomp, their show. Plus, I always wanted to do something which was different than normal routine. My mother is sometimes concerned that it's a male-oriented society and the job I am doing is very different, very extraordinary. So her concern is there, and I respect her concern. But she also stands by with my decision, and like, she is happy for me as well. We get up early in the morning, 5:30, 6 o'clock. Then we just reach to our squadrons, and we take our breakfast, and we rush to our IPs for briefing. They brief us regarding our present day mission, and we go for the aircrafts. We strap up, go for mission, come back. We get debriefs. They are treating same as to males and to ladies. But although there is some difference, there are certain physical limitations, I cannot deny that. But you can say that they do deal us similarly. Most of the people think that Pakistan has very restrictions for women, but I want to say that no, it's not like that. They should come in Pakistan and see what Pakistan is actually doing. The aim of the PF is to train us so that we can become the fighter pilots for Pakistan Air Force. I feel really proud of what I am doing. I really feel honored that Air Force has given me the chance to work with them. PF has changed me in many ways because it has actually groomed me in many ways. It has groomed my personality. It has given me my own identity and a confidence to face the world. I think people would appreciate what I am doing, and they would also think of their daughters and sisters to be where I am today.
The story there of Mariam Muktia, a pilot officer. Now let's return to our main story this hour, the continuing protests in Thailand. Kirsty Kenny is the United States ambassador to Thailand. She joins me now on the line from Bangkok. Ambassador, thank you very much for joining us. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Good morning to you from Bangkok.
Good morning to you. How hopeful are you, Ambassador, that these protests will eventually come to an end, and an end that will be peaceful for the people of Thailand?
You know, we hope that will happen. There are a lot of people in Thailand with strong political views. We've been urging them all to find a peaceful dialogue, a democratic solution forward. And there are some signs that there are people on all sides who are willing and ready to look for some sort of peaceful solution. But I can't promise you that will happen, and I can't say when it will happen.
What is the resolution that you would like to see happen now?
You know, as the United States, a longtime friend and ally, we'd like to see the sort of solution developed by the Thai people that strengthens democratic processes and institutions. one that uses peaceful dialogue, and we hope they'll find that way forward. We've been longtime friends and allies here, 180-year historic partnership, and we'd love to see the Thai come to a great and lasting solution to these issues.
There is, though, is there not, a fear that if this government is to fall, the next administration would be one that has question marks over it, because nobody knows what that might be, and their ability to govern in Thailand?
You know, it's hard to speculate on the future, and I think our focus right now needs to stay on encouraging all sides, not just pro and anti-government, but civil society, business leaders, academics, to find a way toward a peaceful dialogue and keep the focus on the democratic processes and democratic solutions to admittedly incredibly complicated and complex issues.
We know that Bangkok is not that unused to political turmoil. Just give me an idea if you believe that this situation that's unfolding at the moment is very different to the ones that have gone before. I mean, how is America viewing this?
Well, you know, we believe very strongly in the right to peaceful protest, and we've certainly seen several months of peaceful protest. And, you know, we encourage all sides to issue restraint. Some of the protests have been larger, some have been smaller. Some days the protests move to different sites. Again, peaceful protest is one we all respect. I think the difficulty is when we've seen some incidences of violence, particularly during the nighttime hours. We don't really see violence as a good solution to any of these problems. But in terms of the demonstrators, you know, those numbers have come and gone. Some of the sites have greater numbers than others. So, you know, it looks a lot like big peaceful protests in many parts of the world. It's mostly in Bangkok, but there have been protests in other parts of the country, including pro-government protests.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens in the coming days and weeks. Ambassador, thank you so much for your time. U.S. Ambassador to Thailand there, Kirsty.
My great
Kenny.
Pleasure. Thanks.
Now, three sandstone sculptures worth more than $1 million, which were stolen from India 5 years ago, have been returned to the Indian government at a ceremony in New York. One of the pieces is listed as the sixth most wanted artworks in the world. Wendy Urquhart explains.
This is the sculpture of Vishnu and Lakshmi. It dates back to the 11th or 12th century, and it's worth a fortune. Smugglers allegedly shipped it from India to Hong Kong, sold it in Thailand, resold it in London, then exhibited it in New York. It was stolen from a temple in Rajasthan State in 2009, along with another statue. Both were recovered by US special agents after a tip-off. A third piece, a male deity in black sandstone, was discovered by customs officials after smugglers allegedly tried to ship the crated artifact from London to New York, listing it as a $400 handicraft. The three pieces, worth $1.5 million, were handed over to Indian government officials at a ceremony in New York on Tuesday. Relations between the US and India have been tense for weeks after India's deputy consul to New York, Devyani Kobragadi, was arrested, strip-searched and charged with visa fraud. Both countries are adamant that the return of the statues had nothing to do with that. Nevertheless, the fact that the statues were recovered more than a year ago will no doubt raise questions about the timing of their return to India. Wendy Urquhart, BBC News.
A member of Justin Bieber's entourage has been arrested on suspicion of possessing cocaine by police at the pop star's home. Detectives were searching the house in LA after reports that Bieber had pelted his neighbor's home with eggs. Well, let's get the very latest from the BBC's Peter Bowes. He is in Los Angeles for us. Peter, just explain, eggs, neighbor's house, what on earth is going on?
That's what the police are trying to find out. They were looking for any sort of evidence, especially surveillance video, that could try to explain exactly what happened. Certainly the neighbor made a complaint to the authorities that last week his home had been pelted with eggs, and Justin Bieber is accused of being part of that. We don't know the reason why that might have happened, or indeed the full extent of the damage. But this is being taken seriously by the police here, because the damage could be in the tens of thousands of dollars, and any time vandalism causes damage more than $400, it is treated as what's known as a felon here, a serious crime that could result in jail time if the individual is charged and eventually found guilty. So the raid took place early in the morning, about a dozen detectives, and as you mentioned, one person was arrested on suspicion of having drugs. It's been made clear to us that those drugs were not connected to Justin Bieber, who has not himself been arrested, but the authorities are saying that he hasn't been exonerated either in connection with this egg-pelting incident.
OK, Peter, well, thank you very much for bringing us up to date on that incident at Justin Bieber's LA home. For now, Peter Bowes in LA. Thank you.
You've been watching Newsday from the BBC. I'm Babita Sharma in Singapore.
And I'm Kasia Madeira in London. And before we leave you, let's just get a reminder of our main story. The Thai Prime Minister, Yingluck Chinnawat, has insisted that she won't resign. That is despite facing intense pressure from opposition protesters. Lots more on that story and all of our stories, as always, on our website. But from Babita in Singapore, from me in London, thank you very much for watching Newsday from the BBC. Bye-bye for now.
Hi there. Yesterday morning, we were looking at a pretty widespread frost and ice first thing in the morning. It's a completely different morning, though, this morning. And for most of us, that means a mild start to the day. It's going to be pretty cloudy with several bursts of rain moving across the country. A fair breeze blowing as well. Now, you'll start the day with hill fog patches, particularly across the Pennines and working into Scotland. Quite murky for a time as well for Northern Ireland. The coast generally cloudy and pretty misty too. So for most of us, a grey start to the morning, and the rain will be pretty heavy too as it moves into Western Scotland. Here we could see around 20 to 40 millimetres of rainfall through the day. There'll be a thaw of the lying snow as well, so we could see some localised flooding issues with that extra rain. For Northern Ireland, some bursts of rain working in here in the morning, and again, quite murky conditions around the hills. Could be quite misty around the coasts of Wales and southwest England, some showery bursts of rain working in here. A more coherent band of rain affecting eastern counties of England, but for the most part, the rain won't be too heavy, and it'll be a mild start for the vast majority of the British Isles. Now, the number of flood warnings following last week's wet weather continues to gradually ease down, and we should see a further easing of the flooding concerns, even though there will be a little bit more rain. Across the southeast of England, we're looking at maybe around 5 millimetres of rain, perhaps 10 in the wettest areas. These showery bursts will continue to work eastwards, and for most of us, it will stay cloudy from dawn till dusk, maybe a few brighter spells in Northern Ireland later in the day, the highest temperatures around 12 or 13 degrees. Then as we head through Wednesday night time, our cloud and rain tends to ease away. There will be further showers falling fairly widely across the British Isles, and we'll keep a good deal of cloud and a fair breeze blowing. So it shouldn't be too cold a night on Thursday. Again, some hill fog patches are likely across the high ground in Scotland. That takes us on into Thursday's weather forecast, and it will be generally another pretty cloudy day, but a better chance of seeing at least a few limited bright or sunny spells. Again, showers swinging in from the south and west, so particularly frequent showers for Wales and southwest England. Across more eastern areas, you're likely to see fewer of these downpours, but most of us will stay pretty cloudy. As I say, a few limited brighter spells are possible, and temperatures a few degrees down compared with what we'll have for Wednesday. Let's take a look at the weather charts as we head towards Friday. This area of low pressure bringing some useful snow to the Alps, 20 to 30 centimetres, particularly for the French Alps, the Swiss and the Italian Alps as well. So if you're off skiing, things should improve with that snowfall. As far as the weekend goes, well, it looks like we're looking at another band of rain working in across the country for Saturday. That's it for now.
It's not just a news story. This is a social phenomenon.
This strikes me as one of those stories where David Cameron, you know, obviously does understand that this is something that people are worried about.
If you look at the newspapers, they're all covering it very differently. If you look at the politicians, they're all claiming a great success for their own parties.
They think their readers are very concerned about immigration, and they're probably right.
I just cannot understand what Number 10 is up to.
The Papers, every night at 10:30 and 11:30 on BBC News.
It is here in these parliamentary back rooms that those in power are brought to account.
That's not what the whistleblower told us.
Where ministers, chief executives and civil servants must explain themselves.
Please stick to the questions.
And where the truth comes out.
I mean, why didn't you just call a spade for once?
On the nation's biggest issues. Enter these rooms and witness the parliamentary select committees. Tuesday and Wednesday mornings from 9:30, live and uncut on BBC Parliament.
Hello, you're watching BBC News with me, Kasia Madeira. Let's get our main headlines now. Thailand's Prime Minister Yingluck Shinawatra has insisted that she won't resign despite facing intense pressure from opposition protesters. They've blockaded streets across the capital, Bangkok, for the third day in a row. The anti-government demonstrators